Hello and good evening everyone, and welcome to Newham's International Women's Day event. We're looking forward to having a great evening starting now and for the next couple of hours or so. And we're marking this important occasion by holding this to celebrate the countless achievements that women make socially, economically, culturally and politically. International Women's Day 2021's theme is Choose to Challenge, #choosetochallenge, because a challenged world is an alert world. Individually, we are all responsible for our own thoughts and actions all day, every day. And collectively, we can all help to create an inclusive world. From challenge comes change, so let's all choose to challenge. I want to start the evening by just running through some housekeeping matters before beginning to go into the events of the evening. So you're all attendees are automatically muted. So your videos are turned off when joining Zoom webinars. This webinar is being recorded. And again, because everyone's video is turned off, there's no issue there. You'll find a Q&A function in the toolbar at the bottom of your screen. So when you hover onto it, you can use that, because there's not a chat function, which is more familiar to many Zoom users. But as there is a Q&A function, you can post any written questions there, and we will be reviewing and responding to written questions via the Q&A function. So to post one, please click on it and write your question in. This is live, so please be patient and forgiving. We're hoping everything will go swimmingly, but bear with us if there are any hiccups along the way, but I'm sure there won't be. We've got a great bunch of women speaking to you this evening. We have Rokhsana Fiaz, our OBE, Mayor of Newham. We have Delia Barker, who is a Director at Deeds and Words. We have Natasha Eeles, founder of Bold Voices. We have Dellis Smith, head teacher at Grange Primary School, and we have Hina Shah, a community builder and co-lead of Indian Community Care Association in Newham. We're going to start the evening, however, with a short animated video. And this video has been produced by Ada Juzik, who is an illustrator and animator with 6 years experience in graphic facilitation, commercial illustration and animation. And her work is strongly influenced by storytelling, dialogue and investigation, particularly the stories and experiences of marginalized communities. And fantastically, Ada is a Newham resident. So to the video. And one of the things that Ada will be doing with us this evening is she will be taking visual minutes during this webinar. So she'll be creating an illustration that captures the discussions in real time during the event, and that we'll have the opportunity to review at the end of the event. So it'll be a much more creative and visually stimulating way to run an event like this one. I'm now going to move us on, where we're going to start our panel discussion. Our first panelist this evening is Rokhsana Fiaz, OBE, Mayor of Newham. Rokhsana is the first woman and woman of colour to be democratically elected as the Mayor of Newham. She was born in Mile End Hospital, grew up in Newham, and has lived here all her life. She became active in student politics at university, campaigning against racism and the introduction of student loans. After university, she became the national coordinator for an anti-racism organisation working to support the Stephen Lawrence family campaign. She went into political journalism and then established an organisation to ensure communities across the UK remained united and strong while challenging the scourge of racism and Islamophobia. She has led national and international projects and organisations promoting interfaith and global citizenship and champions youth leadership. In June 2009, she was honoured with the Officer of the Order of the British Empire for services to Black and minority communities in the UK. In 2014, she was elected as a councillor for Custom House Ward in Newham, and in 2018 was elected Mayor of Newham. Rokhsana.
Thank you very much, Althea, and thank you to everyone joining us for this really important moment for us as women, and also for those allies from the opposite gender. And I want to also thank and take a moment of my expressing my appreciation for members of the council team who have been involved in arranging tonight's event and working hard throughout the year with a whole raft of female-led organisations to help women in our community. And I'm really glad that we've been able to continue celebrating this really important day, International Women's Day, to continue speaking loudly and proudly about our lived experiences as women, as girls, celebrating our achievements and putting the spotlight on the ongoing challenges we face and how much we have to go to get society to change. And while I know that we're all really excited about getting back to life in person again when we can, there are some benefits to being online which we should continue to capitalise on. Zoom life or Microsoft Teams life has made our events more accessible here at the council, so that having a child and with all the childcare responsibilities, if you're in a family unit, you've got elderly relatives that you need to look after, or you're working irregular working hours, it doesn't have to be a barrier to participation in what we do here as a council. And these are issues that we know affect women more, and there are some legacies of this pandemic which we will want to take with us in our future fight for a better society, one that is very much grounded in gender equality and gender inclusion, because that's a fundamental human right that we should always be advocating for. So it's really great that we can celebrate the contributions and achievements of some of the many women who have made such a big difference across so many parts of our borough. And I thank all of the panelists for giving us their time this evening for us to hear their stories and to be inspired so that we can continue to challenge all those barriers that we face on a day-to-day basis. Newham itself was a borough made by women. The great women of Newham include one of the first female MPs, a woman called Susan Lawrence. And as a borough, we are committed to continuing this legacy. And as we all know, this year's International Women's Day theme is Choose to Challenge. And I'm particularly inspired by this theme because it resonates with me against the backdrop of all the work that I have done across the years for a number of reasons. Presently, one of my biggest challenges that I face, and I know this is a challenge faced by many of my female colleagues that I work with closely here at the council, my fellow female councillors, is the constant online harassment that comes with being a woman in politics. People who are able to express their hatred for women in real life are often all too happy to do so when hiding behind a Twitter handle. It's a tactic to silence women, and it has worsened in Newham over the last few years. It is a concern of international focus, with the likes of the United Nations and the European Commission rallying behind the calls to clean up the social media sphere from hate and violence perpetrated by men, largely against women online. So how can we possibly address gender inequality if we have such a hostile environment for women who wish to participate in the social media space and in digital environments when the hostility and misogyny they face is unrelenting? It's a new terrain of this 21st century that men use to silence women and to expose their violence and hatred to and of them. But with the bad always comes the good, because people standing up together against the bad is really, really important. My fellow female counsellors experienced the same, as I said, and earlier this morning we came together to be able to share our personal stories and the pain that has been inflicted, and we have resolved to overcome it in the spirit of sisterhood by stepping in to defend each other and offering support behind the scenes. We won't let it stop us from representing our communities. And partly this is about the everyday things. It's about that sisterhood and standing up for each other. And that standing up for each other is a important philosophy and spirit of International Women's Day, which celebrates that solidarity that we express for each other. And through that solidarity and standing up for each other, we've also able to focus on bigger actions in the face of the challenges that confront us. I'm incredibly proud that last November council members unanimously voted for a motion calling for misogyny to be recognised as a hate crime. And I'd like to give a shout out to Councillor Mumtaz Khan, who will be with us this evening, for proposing this motion, as it was really inspirational and I was delighted to second it. But it will require us all to take action, including action that can be taken by the council. The objective of this change is to let men know that misogyny will not be tolerated, and that in today's society and in this age, their actions will be challenged. Women and girls should not have to accept this behaviour and should not have to change the way they live their lives to avoid harassment or discrimination or be fearful of violence. And as you all know, this past year, and as we accelerate through 2021, we're still contending with the challenges of COVID-19 that's really brought into sharp focus the gender inequalities that exist both in health and in economic terms. And through our Towards Better Newham action plan, we will be working with residents, with women, to challenge exploitation and abuse, including violence against women and girls. In London, we know that domestic abuse is at epidemic levels and that forms of abuse have widened. And that's why we need to treat violence against women with the seriousness needed. We drew on these issues with our work for International Day for the Elimination of Violence Against Women. Last year, in 2019, our domestic abuse services received 1,814 requests for support from Newham residents. And we know that this is likely to increase for, you know, the coming years because of the impact of the pandemic, particularly the lockdown. And also, as I've mentioned before, the further economic pain that will be inflicted and how that will disproportionately affect women. This is absolutely unacceptable. It's unacceptable in the 21st century in a global city, that is London, and it is unacceptable in any context. The theme of that International Day for the Elimination of Violence Against Women was that we can't let domestic violence thrive in the shadows. Well, we can't let misogyny also thrive anywhere, be that on our streets, parks, or online. So choosing to challenge, which we do every single day in every possible way, requires strength and fortitude, but crucially, it really does show our courage. Take it from me, from personal experience, it can be scary and it can also be tiring, but calling out gender bias and misogyny is also so empowering, and it is a reflection of your confidence. So to all the women here, to all the girls watching this, keep on disrupting and choose to challenge for fairness. Thank you very much, Althea.
Thank you very much, Rokhsana, for those truly inspiring words and some real food for thought there. So thank you. I'm going to introduce our next panellist. I think we've got some presentation coming up. That's the illustration showing, so thank you. I'm going to introduce our next panelist now. And this, our next panelist to speak is Delia Barker. Delia is the Director of Deeds and Words. And Delia works with some of the most dynamic, interesting and innovative communities to put inclusivity at the heart of everything they do. Formerly the programmes director at the Roundhouse, Delia has worked extensively across the cultural sector for over 25 years. Other roles include Director of English National Ballet School and Senior Dance Officer at Arts Council England. She is also Chair of the Board for the Studio Wayne McGregor, who opened a world-class art space at Here East in the Queen Elizabeth Olympic Park, Stratford. In a freelance capacity, she has worked with Drake Music, Boy Blue Entertainment, Stopgap Dance, and Avant Garde, and is a member of the Mulberry School Trust based in Tower Hamlets. Delia is also a Newham born resident. Delia, welcome and thank you. Over to you.
Thank you, Althea, and good evening, everyone. So I'm going to talk to you, as you'll hear from my introduction, I'm going to talk a little bit about gender inequality in the arts. I think one thing that I can absolutely say with certainty is that there is inequality in that sector, in our sector. And you'd only have to do a quick browse on your search engine of choice to find a wealth of articles that will back that up and give out information and facts they show that there has been and continues to be a gender imbalance across many aspects of the cultural sector. And I'm not sitting here speaking to you as an expert on this subject, so please do, if you want to, take a look. As I said, do a search and you'll get a fuller idea. But some of the things you'll see are facts such as only 16% of filmmakers in the UK are female, or that women earn 30% less than men for their creative practice in 2019. You'll see that only 10% of our theatre critics are female. And in 2019, a huge 88% of the work sold at Sotheby's, Great Auctioneer House, was made or created by men. So there is an imbalance and there is an inequality. Now, when I joined the sector at the age of 23, I was really fortunate because my first few roles were in organisations that were led by women. From my time as a trainee at Chisholm Hill Dance Space up in Bow, working with Jive and Lindy Hoppers or Bunty Mathias, through to my time at Arts Admin, all fundamental or foundation steps for me in my career. And I had some amazing role models along the way. I worked around a number of brilliant female artists. I witnessed some fantastic work being made by them, incredible dance, theatre and visual art. And I guess in my innocence, I didn't see gender inequalities at that point in my career because I was probably looking out for more things around my ethnic diversity and me being a minority in that respect. And I don't know if it's the same, I didn't go to an all-girls school, but I imagine that if you're in an environment where you're seeing women do well and play out really strong roles, then the gender dynamics of society play out a bit differently. And so at that point in my career, I didn't see a gender bias and I didn't see that women were not being treated equally. I just saw what was possible. If you roll on now 30 years, which have absolutely flown by, and you're probably working out how old I am now, but I made my way to working at a senior level in the cultural sector in various organisations. I've led an organisation myself. And to be honest, I've had a really good career in the arts so far. I worked, as I said, with some incredible women along the way, as directors, as performers, managers, designers, you know, CEOs, you name it. So I know that there are many, many women involved across the breadth of the cultural sector. And this could sometimes fool you into thinking that things are actually okay in the sector when they're really not. There's still not enough women. There's still not enough women in certain parts of the industry. And there's definitely some way to go before this changes. But it's deeper than just numbers. There's a huge amount of negative impact that is wrapped up in the lack of gender inequality. The impact is that it leads to work by women being undervalued, which then goes on to encourage further undervaluing when it comes to artistic standing. It leads to work going unrecognized or unrewarded, with promotions and commissions and accolades going to mainly to men. It leads to less pay for similar jobs. And it makes one of the worst sectors.
On me now, isn't it? It's like a bit closer.
Sorry. It makes our sectors one of the worst sectors for the gender pay gap. And it leads to underrepresentation in leadership positions. Beyond that, it leads to a dampening of aspirations. It leads to women having to prove their equality, to women not being able to be too female in certain situations, because to be honest, sometimes you can't let female be part of the equation. it also leads to systems and processes not being set up to support women in the sector, which ultimately means that we lose talent or that women end up making continual sacrifices. And it means that we remain unequal. And the saddest thing about all of this that I've just said is that you could probably pick this up and transpose it to a number of other sectors outside of culture, because this is not something that's unique to that sector. Now, this year's theme is Choose to Challenge, as you've already heard. And I think it's a fantastic way for us to think about how our actions support change. It's a reminder that there's still work to do and that we need to continue to challenge in this ongoing context. And it's a prompt for everyone. And that includes the men around us who do and can act as our allies and supporters in not accepting the status quo. And please remember too that challenge can be big or small actions. It may be as simple as ensuring that women are included. It could be as simple as you turning your TV to support women's football and upping the viewing figures. It could be that you don't make assumptions about women if you're in a position to influence decision making, or you sign a petition for a cause, or you start a blog about being female in your industry or your school or your club. Or you might tune into a panel talk taking place to raise your knowledge and awareness, or to celebrate the achievements of women as you have done today. But however you want to interpret this year's theme, please remember it's not solely your job to solve the whole problem. It's everybody's responsibility, and lots of little actions will make a difference. The other thing I want to say is that I'm aware that I've spoken about men and women, and it's quite, you know, left or right in this context. But I do want to make it clear that I'm speaking about all women. If you identify as a woman, you are underrepresented. Now, that's the problem. So I want to talk to you about some of the things that are happening in the cultural sector to redress this balance. At the University for Women in the Arts, they've set up a scheme to mentor the next generation of female leaders. The Women of the World, or WOW Festival, which started in the cultural sector in 2010, led by Jude Kelly, has now reached over 2 million people with the message around gender equality. Creative England have launched their Female Founders Scheme, which is a program to support ambitious female founders of screen-based companies. And more generally, the BBC last year in November, I think, published a list of 100 inspiring, influential women, which I had a look at last year, and I refreshed my memory, and it's fantastic and still on their website. So have a look and find something to inspire you. And a couple of things I want to celebrate, or people I should say. I want to celebrate Michaela Cole for one of the best pieces of primetime TV last year, I May Destroy You, in a world where only 16% of primetime programming is written by females. I want to celebrate Siobhan Davis, who received her Damehood last year for services to contemporary dance, which is a field that mainly sees choreographers more frequently receiving the profile. And I also want to celebrate Josette Bushell Mingo, who has recently become the first woman to be appointed as the principal of the Royal Central School of Speech and Drama since 1942. And that one's a special one for us here in Newham, because Josette grew up in Plaistow. And finally, before I wrap up, I just want to celebrate and acknowledge all the brilliant and inspiring women who are working in the cultural sector and beyond. To all those women who are on a daily basis choosing to challenge in little big ways in spaces where they are underrepresented, and they're continually redressing the balance by simply being there. So be brave, choose to challenge, small actions, collectively we will get there. Thank you.
Thank you, Delia. Thank you so much for that. And again, for some really inspiring words and for some really interesting facts in and amongst those words. And people can see that Ada's capturing some of those real points as we go through, but some very, as I say, some real food, some more food for thought, and part of the, I'm sure will feature very much as part of the Q&A that we'll be going on to do. So thank you. Now moving to our next speaker, Natasha Eeles, the founder of Bold Voices. Natasha founded Bold Voices in 2018 after seeing a need for people to develop a critical awareness of gender inequality. She has an academic foundation in issues of gender and equality with an MSc in Gender and International Relations from the University of Bristol. Natasha has facilitated workshops and delivered lectures on this topic at multinational investment banks, startups, schools, and universities across the UK. And Natasha is going to share some thoughts with us this evening. So, Natasha, over to you.
Hi, everyone. Hi. Thank you so much, Althea, for that intro. And it's really a great honour to be here today and to be speaking alongside such really incredible women. So I'm here to introduce you to the social enterprise that I founded and the reason why the work we do is so needed. So Bold Voices is a social enterprise preparing and empowering young people to recognise and tackle gender inequality and cultures of gender-based violence. And we do this through the facilitation of education in the form of workshops, talks, events and resources in schools and universities, working with over 2,000 people since we were founded in 2019. I founded Bold Voices in the aftermath of completing a master's in gender and international relations. This education was transformational for me, and it was really the first time that I was able to develop the language and the knowledge to understand that experiences of gender inequality shouldn't be dismissed as isolated incidents or excused as simply the way things are. It quickly became clear to me that the only way we'd start to see real change for women and marginalized genders was if we educate young people on what gender inequality is, why it exists, and what we can do to challenge it. And this mission continues to lie at the core of Bold Voices today. So what is it that girls, young women, and marginalized genders are experiencing that we need to talk about? For young people, gender inequality and gender-based violence are very real issues that they learn to manage and navigate from childhood, essentially. There are dozens of issues from microaggressions and everyday sexism, all the way through to extreme forms of violence that girls and women experience as a lived reality. We have a tendency, I think, to think about the fact that these issues are affecting women in other countries or in other communities or other cultures. Rarely do we confront the uncomfortable truth that this is happening in under our very eyes and in our own relationships and our own communities. Gender inequality is complex, and to understand it, we have to both acknowledge how the individuals experience it, but also how there's a big picture, showing how cultures and society as a whole have gender inequality at their very core. We must also understand that there are multiple and overlapping identities that impact on experiences of inequality, such as race, sexuality, disability, religion. Those are just some of the identities that further exacerbate experiences of inequality. For girls and young women, this starts to seep into their lives at very early age, in particular through gender stereotypes, bias, and gendered language. As a society, we continue to bombard young people with the idea that girls are homemakers, are compliant, should be kind, and enjoy playing with passive toys like top dolls over active toys like Lego. We are challenging these stereotypes, but I'd argue that despite them being more identifiable and visible, they are no less prevalent today. And for young girls growing up, we continue to see a lack of diverse representation and role models. Only 34% of our MPs are women, and that's the highest percentage that we've had in history. And this is too reflected within popular culture, something that Delia has touched on this evening within the creative industry. In the top grossing 100 animated films in 2018, female characters made up just 26% of leaders. It's no wonder that girls are less confident in their own abilities, less likely to put themselves forward for leadership roles, less likely to speak out about experiences of inequality. But unfortunately, at the core of gender inequality is this relentless barrage of gender-based violence that girls and young women learn to navigate every day. This often begins with public sexual harassment, catcalling, unwanted sexual comments, threats, stalking, groping. 66% of girls aged 14 to 21 have experienced public sexual harassment. And this harassment adapts to new environments and technologies. As the mayor has already mentioned today, online harassment is now an epidemic. It manifests in image-based abuse, such as cyber flashing, non-consensual sharing of intimate photos, deepfake pornography, but also misogynistic comments, threats of violence and sexual bullying are all highly prevalent online. And young people are experiencing all of these things. They are also not protected from the most extreme forms of gender-based violence either. Sexual assault, female genital mutilation, child marriage, sex trafficking, intimate partner violence. These are horrific experiences that young people are not sheltered from. The impact of these experiences is really hard to quantify. And in part, this is due to the continued silencing of these experiences within society. From a very young age, we expect girls to be silent, to simply put up with this harassment and violence, and to learn to navigate those threats effectively. If they don't manage this, we then subject them to victim blaming, questioning why they behaved in such a way to invite that behavior. At an individual level, we can see that the mental health toll is unimaginable, but we also have to look at the structural level. We have to see how we're bringing up yet another generation who have normalized these experiences of inequality and violence, who've accepted them as part of life without question. The impact of that is to prop up a culture of inequality and gender-based violence that begins in school and childhood and continues through to university, to the world of work, to family relationships, and the very structures of our society. So what can we do about this? Well, when we're talking about overcoming these issues, we have to take a big picture approach. Of course, there are ways we can build the resilience, the confidence of young women and girls, but we cannot really expect girls and women to be fixing these issues themselves. This requires cultural, structural change that we all have to invest in at all levels of society. And unfortunately, there is no roadmap for this. There's no perfect example of what we can follow to achieve it. But at Bold Voices, we strongly believe that starting with education is absolutely the way forward. We have to be having these conversations with young people. We have to be talking to them about what gender inequality is, what it looks like, where it starts, what the repercussions of it are. And it's from there that we can start to create disruptions to that inequality, that we can bring up a young generation who can see how to disrupt it, who can see how to challenge it. And what gives me hope every day is that we are not alone in disrupting this inequality. There have been fierce, strong role models throughout history, and those role models continue to exist today. I wanted also to mention Michaela Cole, who unsurprisingly Delia mentioned too, as the writer, director, and producer of The Incredible I May Destroy You, that demonstrates the disruptive power that popular culture can have to change people's perceptions of these issues. And I also wanted to mention Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, who's a young US Congresswoman who is standing up and speaking about issues that are uncomfortable and that don't make her popular on a daily basis. But there's huge courage in that. She's inspiring a new generation of young people, not just in the US, but across the world, to stand up and fight for causes they believe in. This is the type of energy we want to tap into at Bold Voices. It's the energy we want to bring to International Women's Day this year, energy that will sustain this fight for the rights of women and marginalized genders, not just today, but for the rest of the year, until we see that equality achieved.
Thank you so much, Natasha, for those really fantastic words. And I think that real focus on some of those, you know, some of our younger women and how we can embed this at a very early age is really important. So again, thank you. Over now to our next speaker, who I'd like to introduce, and I'm introducing Dellis Smith, who is the head teacher at Grange Primary School. And I'm sure as a head teacher at a primary school, Dellis, you've been rather busy today. Dellis is the head teacher and she has a passion for learning and is committed to providing the best possible outcomes for the children and young people whom she serves. She is an inspirational leader who seeks to promote the can-do attitude in everything she does. Dellis sits on Newham's Education Partnership Board and the Youth Safety Board. Her experience in education, spans over 20 years and includes working in a variety of inner city London schools with Ofsted grading from special measures to outstanding. Dellis started her journey as a qualified teacher in West London and joined Newham some 17 years ago as a literacy lead. Her experience in leadership includes deputy headship in two very different primary schools. She has successful experience in driving forward improvements to raise standards, which includes working as a seconded HMI inspector for Ofsted. Over to you, Dellis.
All right, thank you very much, everyone, and thank you. I feel really privileged to be on this meeting today. I'm going to share a PowerPoint and a slightly different take because it's going to talk about my journey in education as well as inequality, gender inequality. So if you just bear with me 1 minute, I'm going to bring up my PowerPoint. Oh, sorry, hold on 1 minute, 1 second. Can everyone see that? I'm not sure.
Not yet, though.
Not well. I'm just going to share a screen. Sorry. Can you see it now?
Yes, got it now.
Right, so International Women's Day, I choose to challenge gender inequality. So life's journey, where will it take you? And I think it's really important about life's journey because we all start on a different path than anything else. But before I just talk about my journey in brief, I'd like to share the journey of women worldwide because I think it's important to put into context our struggle and how we still struggle today. 1 in 3 of us will experience violence. 58% of all women are murdered or killed by an inmate, partner, or a family member. 650 women across the globe were married before the age of 18. 100 million children in 30 countries have undergone FGM. 71% of all human trafficking involves women and girls. And 1 in 5 female refugees and internally displaced people have experienced sexual violence in countries affected by conflict. Women spend twice as much, time on domestic work, paid and unpaid, and we work longer hours. Over 2 billion women do not have the same opportunities as men. Less than 1.15% of women are landowners. The gender pay gap was 22% in 2018. And 82 million women worldwide do not have any legal protection against discrimination in the workforce. Every 90 seconds, one of us dies in childbirth or pregnancy. 80% of us are all displaced and refugees are women. Women account for 70% of the population living in poverty. 603 million women live in countries where domestic violence is not considered a crime. And discrimination, violence, and inequality stop women from speaking up about their lives. And it goes on and on and on. So to do nothing is an option. It's really, I'm really pleased about all the speakers that have been on today and talking about gender bias and everything else and how the fight must go on. Because together we are stronger and we must do more, which is, you know, this meeting today is very, very empowering because it gives us an opportunity to share and celebrate success, share new learning, offer support, network, which I feel is really important, and celebrate and challenge, inequality. So my journey, and this is really about inspiration, actually, so to inspire, because I believe the journey of life is a series of ups and downs. It's never straight. And when we're talking about young children in school and girls especially as well, because obviously they're the women of the future, we talk about the growth mindset and to be resilient and overcome all challenges that you might face. So this depicts my journey, not straight, but a series of up and downs. But I believe also what's really important is that it's not the challenges, but it's how you overcome them, and always to have a really positive mindset. So my educational journey started many years ago in a small school in Brent called Anson Primary. And this was a supportive school. It was excellent to start to my teaching career. Excellent start to my teaching career. So it started in, and this picture depicts that the journey is not straight. It's a series of bindy and bendy roads. It was a good school. I learned a lot, and I had a very, very good head teacher who set the bar. But I wanted a bit more challenge. So I went on to work in a special measure school, which was John Keeble at the time. And what it provided was an opportunity to learn, and an opportunity to learn how not to do certain things, but also about systems and processes. So that was really, really key, a key learning point for me and moving on. Came to Newham, as I said, 17 years ago, and started in West Ham Church School as a literacy lead. I found that it was an opportunity again as a promotion. Again, as a woman in school, what I found was there were lots of my colleagues that were men, but they were getting further ahead than I was. But, this is about inspiring everyone to believe that they can and look for those opportunities to learn. So that's what I did in this journey. Worked in an outstanding school, Old Palace Primary and Brampton Primary. So every opportunity was a learning point. Develop the skills and competence for that next role. So I want to encourage those out there that want to do well is to have a dream and to use every opportunity as a way forward and an opportunity to learn. There were barriers that I faced in going to leadership because I was a woman and a woman of colour as well. So I was prejudged for who I was. There's racial bias as well. A lack of CPD opportunities in one school in particular, who wasn't very happy that I was going on to a course and tried to stop the attendance on a course that was specifically designed for women or ethnic people to, into leadership. And again, one of the barriers was actually challenging misconceptions, toning down overconfidence, like, who do you think you are? The reason why I share this is because actually I want to say that there are barriers in life, but it's how you overcome them. It's using those setbacks to be more determined, using those setbacks to go forward. Looking at it and learning from it and never stopping to try and to achieve well. So my journey continued in working in Leys Primary and again Brampton Primary before seeking headship at Grange Primary. I was told no a lot, but I never stopped. I used every single opportunity to learn. And push forward. And I found that the journey into leadership as a woman and as a woman of colour was a lot more challenging than my journeys into other roles that were non-leadership. So I finally had a yes after many, many interviews and pushing through and not stopping at Grange Primary School. I've been there almost 5 years now and I have transformed the school. It is a learning environment, obviously, like my schools. But what I am saying is we do go along the premise of a growth mindset. All children are valued, male and female, but we do especially push the girls to dream big, to believe big, to have the I can attitude, to never give up, to always persevere, because I believe that's what will get you through to whatever it is you're trying to achieve. The barriers we can't negate because they're there, but it's the attitude that will determine how far you go. And that's the message we tell our children in our school. They have to believe they can. So I would like to leave my parting message to the women out there to say, I don't know what your journey is and what it is you're trying to achieve. And what it is you're trying to break through on, but successful women never give up. Have a vision, have a goal. Be determined and use setbacks as an opportunity to learn. And it's really inspiring about, you know, the women that we've listened to and how they've done that. Evaluate where you are on the journey and adjust your actions accordingly. Learn from your mistakes. Understand that not all doors will be open when you want them to be, but if you're persistent, they will open eventually. And be confident in who you are and who you've been created to be. When you've done all you can, just stand as who you are. So I just wrote this little poem very quickly, and it was just to kind of encapsulate all that I was talking about, the women worldwide, the struggles they still go through, the barriers we still face today. But, you know, we've got a range of successful women in this meeting, leading it, facilitators, and those out there who are just listening to this presentation. So a strong woman, a choice. I have no choice. I choose. I choose to survive, to be strong, to live my life unafraid of doing wrong. I choose never to give up of being who I am, always reminding myself of how much I can. I choose to be everything that God has created me to be and refuse the word failure to live within me. I choose to survive, for so many have gone before without opportunity. How can I possibly not justify not opening the door? So I want to just say, you know, be inspired, be encouraged, never give up, be persistent. Whatever that journey is, just keep on pushing through and you will get there in the end.
Thank you, Dellis. That was truly great. And thank you for that poem that we ended on there. I think that we can all relate to those words, and I think we all do relate to those words. So thank you for that. Now we're moving on to our final speaker from the panel before moving on to the next section of this evening. So I'd like to introduce you to Hina Shah, who is a community builder and the president of the Indian Community Care Association in Newham. Hina is a Newham resident who has lived in Plaistow for over 30 years. She's now retired, but had a varied career, including working for the Post Office, Boots, Connects Railway, and finally working for the London Borough of Newham in the libraries and the local service centre. Though retired, Hina is still active in her local community. She is an active Newham volunteer, Plaistow Community Ambassador, and a Plaistow Citizens Assembly Working Group member. Hina is currently president of the Indian Community Care Association in Newham, an over 50 social group, while making time to volunteer for Oxfam. Over to you, Hina.
Thank you. You can hear me?
Yes, we can hear you, Hina. Go ahead.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. Thanks to the introducer, mayor, panelists, ladies and gentlemen. Thanks for inviting me and giving me a chance to tell my story. As we celebrate 8th March, International Women's Day, at the same time, February 13 is observed as National Women's Day of India. They celebrate the birthday of Sarojini Naidu, as she was a world-known freedom fighter for India. She was famous for her nickname, Nightingale of India, or Bharat Kokila, because of her well-known poems. She was a great inspiration to my family, and my grandmother was a great follower of her. So I was born and brought up in India, Mumbai. I grew up in a cultured and religious family. I grew up watching my grandmother, mom, aunt, all well-educated and active women. They not only looked after the family and house, but also went to work. One of my aunt was a teacher, and one of my aunt was a head teacher of a primary school in Mumbai. I myself was also a teacher in Mumbai. I got married in 92 and came to UK. I worked very hard in all different environments. Started from post office counter, booths. I started working in Connex Rail, where there was no any Asian women. I was the only Asian lady working. After that, to look after my teenage son, I shifted and I got a job in Newham. I started with a library assistant, and then I started in a housebound service. In that job, I got more connected to community groups, and that way I got more involved in community groups. I have always accepted challenges, always got great support from my family, my mother-in-law, my husband, and my son. I had a passion to do stage shows, that is in Gujarati dramas. And I did all the shows, not only in all over the UK, but also I went to USA to perform the show. And at that time, not only my family and my friends, but my manager, Pat Lloyd, who also inspired me and encouraged me. And even he had a language barrier. He would not always understand my language, but he always understood my body language. And he always came to support me. And he always came and watched my show. And not only my family, but my friends also gave me a great support. And my community also supported me. Now, as I got retired and I had more time, I got more involved in voluntary work. I got more active with ICAN group, that is Indian Community Care Association of Newham, which is a 50 plus group. It has more than 70 members, and I started as a member. And now I'm a president of the group. I made the group more active with the Plaster neighborhood support. We always got involved in the projects at every event. Every week we had different activities in the group. Summer, we always try to arrange two or three day trips for the members so they could enjoy the weather and they can explore themselves. We have well-being activities like Zumba, yoga, meditation, exercise, and this is all arranged and supported by the Plaster neighborhood. Plaster Library has always supported the house, and they have always encouraged in doing all different projects. We have singing, dancing, and we also celebrate festivals like Christmas, Diwali, and others. ICAN is a group of more men than women, but as being a woman, they selected me as a president, and I got more involved in that working group. And I'm also a member in a working group members, which I help to design projects. I have also spoken in one of the citizen assembly. I'm also a street ambassador as well, which make me proud as well. And I always get good support from the community and all my neighbors and my families and friends. I also do knitting and crochet groups in Green Street Library as well, where we always make baby blankets, baby sets, and we give to the Newham General Hospital and Thomas and Guy's Hospital for the newborn babies, which we have some pictures in the newsletters of Green Street. We also donate blankets for the kittens and puppies, like in Celia Ahmed, Battersea Park Charity, and others as well. While I was doing all this, and while I do all this, two of my knees were so inspired through me that one of my knees is a head teacher in a dyslexia school in Dubai, and one of my knees, she's a branch manager in Mumbai, in a big bank, in a government bank. I think International Women's Day is not only one day. Every day is an international day, because as women are not weak, their most strong human on earth. Every challenge makes us change to our life. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Hina. That was really great. I love that story of your journey and how you've woven that into the contribution that you're making and the example that you're setting here in Newham. So thank you so much for that. Okay, we're going to move on to the next part of our evening. And just to let participants know, to let guests know, we're running about 10 minutes late so far, but I'm sure, like me, you are really enjoying what you're hearing and what we're seeing, and I'd much rather us be able to include everything rather than cut it short to be slaves to a clock. So I'm really hoping that you are able to stay on those extra 10 minutes or so that we'll need to complete the event. The next woman that I'm going to introduce to you is to Elam Forrester. And Elam is going to lead a discussion with young women on the theme of Choose to Challenge. But rather than me talk about Elam, I'm going to go straight to her so that she can introduce herself and tell us all what she's going to be doing for the next 25 minutes or so. So over to you, Elam.
Hello, and
Elam, you're on mute, so I think you may need to have one of your devices open and one closed, because I think it's when both devices are open we get that feedback. Try now. Still on mute. So Elam, we can't hear you yet. Okay, guests, bear with us. This is what we said earlier. We are live, so we do get little glitches like that, but it will definitely be worth waiting for. So bear with us. Elam, how are you doing? Whilst we're waiting for Elam to get connected again, or she's connected, but to unmute and to introduce the young women she's going to be speaking to, can I remind you all of the Q&A function and ask you to post your questions so that we can go to those questions later on? I think we've got Elam now. Go, Elam.
How do I sound?
Okay. Still a little bit of that feedback. I don't know if it's because you've got two devices.
Going on. Okay.
So Elam, you will have picked up, I am no technical whiz, but I think if you turn the volume down on one of the devices that you're using, that may help. I think it usually happens when you've got two things logged into the same meeting or webinar and they both have volume up, but I am no expert in this. I'm hoping those more technical than I am will be able to help. It's a good opportunity for guests to think about their questions. So Elam, how are you doing?
Can you hear me?
Brilliant, well done.
Fantastic.
Thank you. Worth waiting for.
Right, I'm going to get straight into it. Apologies for the delay. I'm Elam. I'm from The People Speak, and we're all about facilitating conversations. And it's really great to see a lot of familiar faces here as well. So I'm going to introduce the young people that have lived and grown up in Newham. We've got Loreen, we've got Lily, Alicia, and Shantae. And they're four young women from the Newham Youth Zones. They've all volunteered with the Help Newham Hubs during the summer last year. So I'm sure they'll have a lot to talk about when it comes to that. And also, we've had the discussion to have a chat about what Choose to Challenge means to them and what life has been like growing up as a girl and young woman in Newham. And, you know, how gender inequalities can show up in different areas of our lives, even from primary school. So we also spoke about the importance of intergenerational conversation. So, you know, and I think that's what's great about today. We've got young people having the opportunity to chat to all of these fantastic panelists. So let's start with yourself, Laureen. Do you have any questions for any of the panelists? I mean, there's so much to talk about. Do you have any questions there?
Not so much a question, just a bit of a statement, because listening to everyone's speeches today, it was quite a big thing I saw was education. I think if young people are educated about equality and just like the rights of, like, we're all equal and we should be treated equal, a lot can change in the future, because I think it all starts from the young people and how they portray things like equality. And I think so far hearing that today, that will make a big difference in how things are viewed today.
But how do you think young people can be trained to sort of learn about inequality? You know, what's something that can be done, or something that maybe the panelists can share that might help in the understanding of what equality is for young people?
So I think for me, growing up, it was kind of, when I was younger, I kind of had a chat. I kind of got told, it's like, okay, so you're a woman and you're a girl and you're Black, so you're going to have to work 10 times as harder than what a male would do to get the same role. And I think hearing that was like, but why? You know, like, that doesn't sound fair. But I think instead of growing children up like that, grow them up as, well, yeah, you're different in certain ways, but you should be treated the same. And for me, if I had a daughter and a son, I will grow them up as equal as I hope any other parent would. And I think just teaching them in the schools, like, no, your role isn't to stay at home, or no, your role isn't to go out and work. Just little things like that will make a big difference in society and the way we view each other as peers. Yeah.
Wow. That is really insightful. I know we have a head teacher here, actually. So I'm wondering if, you know, you were talking about things we can share with young people, and how even the things that we're told growing up, you know, you're going to have to work harder, you know, being Black, you know, all of these things can have an impact on how you kind of view equality. But I wouldn't mind putting that question to, you know, the head teacher, hearing some of the things that, you know, Laureen said. Do you have any thoughts about that, you know, since, you know, you have experience dealing with children on a daily basis in schools?
I think that education is key, I would say, definitely. I think that you are going to face a barrier. So I understand the messages that, you know, being a Black, you've got to work harder and everything else. And we are doing a lot to break down the barriers. What I would say is that you do have to have resilience and be determined. We want the world to be a better place. We are still fighting some of the battles that we fought when I was younger. I've learned from what my mum's passed on to me. My mum used to say to me when I was young, I remember saying, she used to say to me, try as hard as you can, you'll get there at last, you know, don't keep on trying. And it's interesting, I put that in my mantra at school. So all my kids are saying, you know, try until you succeed at last, because actually I think it's, you know, it can be a race thing, it can be a gender thing, it can be anybody's thing. You're going to get barriers in life. That's it. There's black and white, there's cause and effect. It's about your mindset and how you choose to challenge that. Don't let anybody put you in the box. You are who you are. You are all unique. Every one of us in this meeting, we're individuals. We are unique in the way that God made us. Be proud of who you are. Push through. Yeah. Don't let anyone tell you can't do. If you are determined and you feel a passion in your heart to do something, go ahead and persevere it. And I will say to you, the best thing you can do, research, educate, you know, be that person. often lack of confidence means that I don't know quite how I'm going to try it, but I'm not quite there yet. But when you know your stuff, you come up confident. I know. Now I challenge you to tell me that I don't know, because I do. And I think every employer wants somebody who can. So I think that it's about self-belief. I think it's about knowing the barriers are there anyway. I think doing a lot to break down those barriers by being who you are, push back on those stereotypes, whether it's gender stereotype, whether it's a person, push back on that. And I think that you'll break it through, because they'll see that you are just who you are, and they'll give you an opportunity to do what you need to do. But I think perseverance, and if you think about all those people that have been successful, they're the ones that may not have been the brightest, may not have been the most gifted, they're the ones that kept on trying. They never stopped. They broke through. If I can leave anything with you, it's to keep on. Yeah, it's not easy. I'm not going to sit here and say, yep, it's easy, because it's not. I think once you know that, that you will, you know, you'll persevere. And look at all those women on the, you know, on the chat. Mare herself, she had barriers. She's talked about her barriers. They've been inspirational, but she didn't give up. She's who she is, and she doesn't make any excuse for who she is. She's herself. And that's, I think, I respect that. You know, I do. So I think, yeah, persevere and keep on. Mm-hmm. Invest in you.
Yeah, no, thanks for that. Thank you so much for sharing your knowledge in the area. And your story is all about overcoming challenges and persevering to get where you got today. And I love what you said about having like a mantra, like a daily mantra to build confidence, because in our chat that we were having, you know, one of the things that one of the young people brought up was how to build confidence. You know, nowadays you've got social media pressures, maybe pressure from your family, and how do you kind of, you know, keep that confidence going? Lily, I'm gonna put it to you actually. Do you have any questions for the panelists? And, you know, how do you build confidence? And, you know, is there any points that you heard today that you wouldn't mind, you know, finding a little bit more about from some of the panelists?
No, I don't really have any questions right now, but how I find confidence, well, it is Women's Day, so I think we have to all just come together and kind of build up that courage and just support one another along the way, because if we don't do that, then how are we all going to succeed in life, and how are we all going to manage if we don't have that strength and bond and unity? And I feel like that's really important as us women, that we stand together, because it shows how powerful we are and what we know our worth is. And I think every woman should understand what they're capable of, because to be honest, we are pretty badass and we can do some incredible stuff when we put our minds to it.
Mm. So at school, how do you kind of like build that that support amongst your friends and amongst the people in your school? You know, how do you kind of, I know you were talking about support in, you know, women should support each other. How do you do that? How do you support your friends? You know, what would be a good example of showing that, you know, comradeship between women?
Tearing each other down is a no-go. Like, we don't stand for that tolerance. It's not a thing. Like, we don't have it. Like, it is banned in our society. Like, it's not happening. To build each other up, we advise whenever you need it. Just anything that you need, like, just come to us and we'll be there for you. Like, if you need a friend to cry along the way, then we'll be there. We'll cry with you. Anything that you need to stand with you, then do it. Like, because that is the type of people we are, and that's who we were made to be, and that is who we were born to be. Like, we have to stand united. It's not about, oh yeah, I can do this better, or yeah, I can do that. But no, it's not about that. It's not about thinking you're better or tearing this person down or doing that or doing that. You can't be fighting against one another. You have to be working together, because that's how God made us. We're all equal, and we have to show that strength, love and pride.
You know, I love what you said about strength, love and pride, and how that kind of, it seems to me that that's how you kind of operate in your life. I wanted to kind of bring in I know that Natasha, you know, you created a whole business called Bold Voices, and it's all about, you know, you saw the need for people to develop critical awareness around gender inequality. I mean, what do you think about some of the things that Lily was saying, and do you have any kind of tips to share about how to kind of like build a sense of, you know, confidence among women, among friendships, you know? Do you have anything to share?
Yeah, I mean, first of all, I just want to say how, I don't know how amazing that is to hear young women talking in that way. I think it really shows how we have a new generation coming through who are really committed to creating new kinds of friendships and bonds between women. And sadly, I don't think that's always been the case, but it's really incredible to hear that. I think the power of that can't be understated. But I also think, I think the value in creating spaces for young girls, for women to come together and talk about some of the challenges that they're having is really, really important. So often you find that when you're sharing issues, whether it's something that's happened to you in school, whether it's even like health concerns you're having, I mean, so often we see that when you start to talk about them, you realize how normal it is. I think just normalizing having these conversations in general is so, so important, and being vulnerable with each other and sharing. And you know, the work that we do in those groups is so important, but we have to have the courage then to take it outside of that as well, and to be able to have that conversation with the men and the boys in our lives as well, because you know there's only so far we can go if we only work with ourselves. So yeah, I think using that space to gain that courage and to know that you have women alongside you, and then being able to take that to the next level and continue those conversations is hopefully the way that we can start to take those steps forward.
Mm-hmm. I mean, you made some really great points there, like, you know, sharing different challenges with other women, because obviously when you do that, you feel, you know, you can get advice and maybe feel like you're not so alone, but also, you know, sharing all of these gender inequality issues with the boys, men in our lives, because I suppose they're part of the whole journey of, you know, fighting gender inequalities as well. Just in the chat, I can see that somebody said, you know, also our young people can choose to challenge the narratives that society puts on them. Be yourself, not someone else's version of yourself. So choose to challenge, you know, be yourself. You know, we often hear that slogan, you know, kind of put out there, be yourself. How do you be yourself? Also, I just wanted to say that if you do have any questions, feel free to pop it in the chat. I will be, you know, highlighting some of them, so feel free to fill up that Q&A box as well. So I'm gonna pass it on to, let me find out what you think, Shantae. I know you've only got your audio available. So what do you think about this whole idea of being yourself? You know, how do you be yourself? Or what do you think about some of the things that has been spoken about so far?
I mean, I don't really have much to say. But I'm just going to base it off the fact of, oh, girls can't do sports. Because personally, I think people shouldn't really have that stereotype. Even though girls are just like, just as able as boys to do certain stuff. And they have this mad stereotype saying we can't do certain stuff just because we're women. But that's not fair, because for certain stuff, women are better than boys. You can't lie.
Okay. So a bit of an empowering message there. From coming from yourself, Shantae, women are better than boys. I wanted to bring the mayor of Newham into the conversation, Rokhsana Fiaz. I know everyone is very well aware of Rokhsana. And Rokhsana, I was just wondering, you know, do you have, and I know we've heard from, you know, the head teacher about how she's overcame any challenges, but what about yourself? You know, how did you overcome some of your challenges that you may have faced? How did you build confidence? Any tips that you can share with some of the young women in the chat here today?
Oh God, that's such a hard question. And you've caught me unawares. I think it's about, recognizing who and from where you can draw inspiration. And there are so many women in my life, throughout my life, including my mother, that I draw inspiration from, and I see them and, you know, I experience them challenging patriarchy and misogyny in very different ways, but all of those inspired me. And it's also about recognizing that there are moments where it really does feel overwhelming and it can become quite scary, and it's the comfort of knowing that you're not alone, that you are with a group of women that will support you, and the importance of self-care and just stepping out of it, because constantly challenging is the thing that we have to do in so many different ways, and it can get quite tiring and exasperating, but self-care is really important.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, thank you for sharing that. I'm just looking at the illustration now, which is so good. There's definitely some shocking statistics on there. I mean, 1 in 3 women will experience, you know, violence, you know. I mean, that is must be quite scary for maybe young people to kind of read as well, but it's a shocking truth. Alicia, I just wanted to bring you into the conversation, because I know that you're talking about, you know, how can elders kind of sort of older people talk to young women about opportunities, you know, different access to different opportunities. How can like older women kind of share the knowledge of accessing different opportunities? Are you able to expand on that a little bit now that we are here?
Yeah, so we have a head teacher here and everything, I feel like it's always the older generation that will, you know, educate the younger generation. And I feel like within the education system, we should, you know, have more, you know, acknowledgement to, you know, women. That's the way it starts, because you learn your first set of norms and values within the family, and then your second come from education. And I do feel as though if some girls within some families experience patriarchy, the next set of, you know, the place where they will learn will be school. So I do feel like if in school, like, you know, teachers and whatnot, if they could, like, you know, educate and whatnot, then I do feel like that would be a very good starting point, because it's always going to be older people educating younger people, you know, giving us their wise and wisdom. So, yeah.
Well, I mean, I know we did speak about maybe some of you guys maybe like teaching some things to some people who are older to you. What is something that you would like to maybe like teach somebody who's older than you about your life and your experiences?
I feel like, you know, obviously some older women, you know, face patriarchy and whatnot, because it's just nowadays that, you know, we are moving more towards like equal rights for women. So I feel like if I was to talk to like someone older, I would just like, you know, tell them about all the opportunities that, you know, we could potentially experience if we do, you know, like tackle, like, you know, this whole like gender inequality thing, and how nice it is to, you know, get to experience your life to the fullest, because obviously in the past women couldn't do certain things, obviously, like vote and whatnot. You know, it's nice to have your opinion being taken into account, like that there's just one small thing that, you know, feels good. So I feel like it's like about understanding that you can also take part in a lot of things, and how good it is, you know, to feel like you're included and you're an equal to everyone else, like within society.
Mm-hmm. No, thank you for that, Alicia. I wanted to kind of maybe bring in and, you know, see if, you know, Delia Barker, I know that you've worked in theatre for your career. Like, what do you think the importance, what do you think the importance is of like theatre and acting? How important do you feel that can be for like young women in terms of maybe building confidence? Do you have anything to kind of talk about in that area?
Yeah, certainly. First of all, I just wanted to pick up, I don't know if you saw it in the chat, just pick up on Alicia's comment. Please don't assume that because we're older that we the teaching only goes one way, because I've learned a lot from just listening to you all speak already. And the other thing is that, you know, we people like myself, Rokhsana, you know, we're already up in our spaces. We can sometimes speak freely, and sometimes we have to speak diplomatically and tactfully and strategically, and we've got all these things around how we can speak. And what you have as young people is the freedom, absolute freedom, to speak your truth. We don't always understand. I don't know what it's like to be a 15, 16 year old woman in Newham right now. I know what it was like for me back then. So please speak, and don't assume that we know, because we have the learning's got to be two ways. Otherwise, it'll always be one set of one generation's version. So I just wanted to say that. In terms of, for me, for the cultural sector, I think why it's important is because people talk about art imitating life. And I think if we see ourselves represented, not only on stage, but off stage, if we see ourselves, if the stories for women and about women are written by women, they ring truer for us. They speak more clearly about our experiences. But also, you know, one of the things I talked about in terms of my journey is that I was surrounded by women who made it possible for me. So they understood my challenges around childcare. You know, there's so many times that my two-year-old son was in the basket next to me on my, you know, in the blanket or next to me near my desk so that I could come to the office. Now that might not be possible in every way, but actually having other women who wanted to make the context for me easy so that I could work was invaluable. And so for me, having a sector that is more equal in terms of women that have a bit more of an understanding of some of the challenges that we face, some of those barriers, and are in a position to change it or to help it make it easy for us is fantastic. But for me, it's about if you don't see yourself, you can't be what you can't see in so many circumstances. And so it's about understanding that whether it's on, you know, in front of the camera, behind the camera, right in the stage, at box office to being picking up that Oscar, that we see ourselves represented fairly and then we can aspire to those things.
Yes, so it's all about representation. And I like what you said about, you know, women creating art for women by women, and also making sure you kind of surround yourself with like a support network of people like you. It kind of reminds me of what Alicia and Natasha were saying about, you know, making sure that, you know, you kind of have people around you who you can maybe share your struggles with. I'm sure you can, and I suppose people of different ages as well, so you can learn from other people's experiences. I can imagine this is all really valuable, and wow, I feel like there's so much more I could ask you about, you know, your career and all of the panelists really. And that brings me to, I'm going to open up the Q&A in just a sec, but I just wanted to find out from Lorene, Lily, Alicia, Shante, do you have any more questions that you'd like to ask the panelists?
Sorry, I do have one. I just wanted to know, this is a broad one to anyone who would like to answer, but if you were 16 now or a young person now in Newham, because how would you go about speaking, vocalizing the issues, and what changes would you propose?
Wow, that's a good question, actually. Maybe we can direct that one to Hina Shah. What do you think about that question? If you were 16 now, you know, yeah.
Oh, if I was 16 now, I would like to take more challenge and accept the challenge and try to overcome the challenge and make something new and change. Like when we say like, girls can't do this, ladies can't do this, ladies can't be a good driver. I think the ladies are the best driver because men can drive roughly. They have no, you know, they don't care. Ladies care for everyone. Ladies have that kind of heart God has given, you know. They care for the children, they care for their husbands, their friends, their family, mother-in-law, mom, father-in-law, father, everyone. They will care for everything, everyone, and they're more emotional. Ladies get more emotional. So at 16, if I'm now 16 and I've given a challenge, I would like to take challenge. I would like to prove that I can do something which no one can do it. Yeah. I think that's my view.
Yeah, so you would definitely challenge things more, you know?
I have done when I was young as well.
Wow.
I had taken challenges when I was very young.
Do you have any stories that you might like to share where you
met? Yeah, I can. I can share with you, yeah. When I was young, and then I was in my teen, and I was the first one in my family to go out and give tuition to the children, to young children, like kindergarten in India, in Mumbai. We give private tuition to the young children to teach them how to write, how to study, how to read. And that was what I did. And I stood next to my dad financially to help him. And I was just 14. That was a big challenge in my family. No one thought I would do that.
Yeah.
And I was the only daughter in my dad's huge family. I was the only girl went to convent school, and all went in our language school, in our normal, you know, normal Gujarati language school. And I was the only one. And that was my dad said, it's a challenge for her. She will do it. And I did it. And that education helped me when I came to this country.
Yeah. So
I didn't struggle.
So even from a teenager, you've been, you know, speaking up. Wow, that's yeah. not sure. You probably inspired so many people in your family and in your local community. I just wanted to bring in something that Cyrus said in the Q&A. Cyrus said, you know, there are a number of female head teacher roles and they are doing their best to inspire young women. The head teacher at my daughter's and son's secondary school is in her 30s. So, hey, you know, things are changing. I know we don't have much time, so there's a question in the Q&A, and it asks, who has inspired you most as women? But I'm gonna put that to some of the young women from Newham, as well as some of the panelists. Who has inspired you most?
You're asking me only same thing?
You know what, I'll put it out to some of the young women, yourself, or any of the panelists, really. Or maybe, Delia, who has inspired you most?
I mean, that's really difficult because I could, you know, I've often said my mum for many, many reasons, but because, you know, she's always shown me that actually the way to uplift your community, and whether that's your community, as in your neighbours, your family, your church, other women, is through kindness and through network and through support. So I would say for me, personally, it's my mother, but lots of women inspire me, and you know, lots of people today have inspired me. So you know, I think yeah, one person for me is my mother, but I remain open to be inspired every single day.
Yeah So your mum is up there. And how about yourself, Rokhsana? I know you answered in the chat, but you know, who inspires you?
Oh gosh, right, you always ask me the hard questions. So just building on what I said previously, look, honestly, in the context of the role that I occupy now, what really inspires me is the young people in our borough, and listening to the young ladies here really gives me confidence that the borough is secure given the future leadership that's with us this evening. And I know that long after I've gone, whenever that will be, but don't worry, I'm not going to stay here forever and ever and ever. Amongst the ladies here, the young girls here, there will be many of you that will step forward and take on the leadership roles to help shape the future of our borough as we continue contending with the challenges. And there will be many challenges, not least us recovering from COVID-19, which will take a long time, but I feel comforted and inspired by the young girls, ladies here tonight. Thank you.
Mm. Oh, great. We also have a question in the chat. It says, healthcare information suggests that the pandemic could put gender equality back by years as a result of women doing significantly more domestic chores and family care. What are your thoughts on this? Does any of the panelists have any response to this or any thoughts on this? I mean, will this whole pandemic set, you know, women's rights kind of back because we, you know, women are spending more time at home? You know, what do you think, Dellis, about this, Dellis Smith? What do you think about this? I know it's
hard. Hi. Hello. Yeah. I'm not sure if you can see me. I've unmuted my camera. I don't know. I think that obviously the pandemic is what it is, and at the moment I think people are just doing the best they can with surviving. I don't know whether this is a very difficult, challenging question, I would say. I think that women, you know, they're at home doing what they do. Women, as somebody mentioned in the chat, they're nurturers, they're carers, they look after, it's what we do instinctively. We just look after. And I think that I don't think it's about putting women back years because you're at home and doing domestic work. I do feel we still have a choice in what you do. I know, for example, I'm at home right now. We share the chores. I might cook, my husband might cook. I don't feel that, you know, I'm here doing more than what I would normally do. And I look after and nurture. And I don't know whether that's because people put women in the box, like your gender roles, you've got to be doing this. And I know that some people don't want to do it. I think that, you know, I personally don't believe that women's been put back, but I can't really answer for everyone. I think that the pandemic is as it is, and people are just doing what they need to do in order to survive this very difficult time. I think that when things get back to normal, you'll see things normalizing. But I do feel that women are, obviously people are working from home, so they might be doing more than they would normally do at home. And as my PowerPoint said, we as women work longer hours, and we do more domesticated work. And that is fact. I mean, I've got that from World, Women's Organization, that women do more domestic work anyway. I'm hoping it hasn't put us back, put it that way. But I know that I will do what I need to do in order to get on. And in fact, sometimes doing, you know, things around the house, which I would normally do, got more time, than I'll do it. So, share responsibilities and everything else.
Share responsibilities. I just want to bring in a comment from the chat. So Jules Cordis is saying, I love the artist and how she's making the event really engaged and thought-provoking. Where can we find the finished piece of work? Also, will this be accessible after the recording? I'm sure Althea will share the information at the end of this. I know, Rokhsana, you have a response to that question, actually, about, you know, the healthcare information that has been released recently. Are you able to share your response so we all can kind of hear what you have to say in response to that?
Thank you very much. So just really building on the written response that I put in the Q&A chat. So look, from the outset of COVID-19, the pandemic and lockdown that started last March, and we're now a year in to that experience, we knew from the outset that the economic impact would be really, really hard here in Newham. And for all of those that haven't seen it, there was a really powerful article in the Financial Times that was published on Friday, and we'll see if we can get the link onto the chat for people to look at. And it really was a strong and powerful testimony of the health and economic impacts of COVID-19. From the outset, we began to work on understanding the significance of COVID-19 in both economic terms as well as health terms. And what we had in any case started when I stepped into office was an approach that very much centred on equality, that anchored our approach to the economy and through around what the council did. You know, the likes of the International Monetary Fund, the OECD have said very clearly, and this was going back as far as sort of April, May time last year, mm-hmm. that women and young people in particular would be worst hit economically. And that's because they occupy roles and jobs in our society that's been very much scarred because of measures that national government has pursued over the last 10 years, ordinarily known as austerity, that has really impacted women. And we've got a growing number of households in poverty. And the baseline that we started from before COVID-19 was really, really bad. And we knew from the outset that we needed to really redouble our efforts and accelerate the addressing of the gender as well as the race disproportionality of COVID-19. So we, you know, back in 2019 introduced the London Living Wage to all care workers. A significant number of our staff, all of our staff get paid the London Living Wage. A significant number of our staff team here at the council are women, so they benefit from the London Living Wage. And last week we were able to formally announce, and I announced at full council last Monday, that we've been officially accredited as a London Living Wage council. So it's those types of measures that we are putting in place to help address those enduring issues of poverty and inequality that particularly impact women and women of colour in this borough, because we cannot continue with an economic system and an economic model that marginalises women in the way that it has done over the last 20 years, because we, you know, the levels of poverty and inequality are simply unsustainable, and it's a human right to have, you know, access to that support and to have a, you know, a living wage for you to be able to put food on the table. We've got a crisis in this country, a crisis where kids are not able to eat properly. And, you know, we have guaranteed the Eat for Free scheme that enables families to save £500, because we resource and finance the feeding of our primary school kids. But I'm really, really concerned about the number of older children in secondary schools that are needing to access food vouchers. So we've got a big issue of food security that reflects the precarious nature of households which are led by women that we've really got to address, and we're absolutely focused in doing that.
Wow, I mean, thank you for highlighting, you know, some of the issues that are affecting people that live in Newham. I'm sure many people will maybe muse that, you know, secondary school children are having to, you know, get food vouchers and, you know, the struggles that some women are facing. Okay, so it looks like our time has come to an end. I've really enjoyed hearing all everyone's voices, but now I have to pass it back to Althea.
Well, thank you so much, Eleanor, for that fantastic hosting and managing both the Q&A and the interaction. Well done, brilliant, so impressed. So yes, unfortunately, everybody, we have come to the end of our time together, and it's gone really, really quickly. And I'm not going to add to all the brilliance that's been shared and spoken about this evening, because I don't think I could possibly add anything that will bring any greater value than has already been covered. So what it leads to me to do is, well, firstly, is to mention Ada's brilliant illustration that you can see in front of you. There was a question about, will that be made available? It will. It will be shared on our website and on our socials. So that will be available. The recording will also be available, so you can see it. And I hope everyone has had an opportunity to follow the Q&As as we've gone through this evening, because there have been answers being posted along the way. So hopefully everyone's had a chance to have a look at that. So what it leaves for me to do is really to thank you all as guests for attending, for being part of this, for participating. There have been so many words of inspiration tonight about strength, about how we build each other up, and importantly, how we don't pull each other down, about challenge, sharing of experiences. I've certainly had a really inspired evening. It's been great for me just to be able to listen and absorb so much of what has been spoken about. And I want to thank all of our panellists for contributing to making this such a good evening. And I want to thank Ellen for her fantastic hosting and facilitating for that. And I also want to thank our young women for contributing. And I shouldn't say our young women, because I've heard the age thing about not just separating the young from those, but I think Ellen, the group that you've brought together of Natasha, Alicia, Laureen, Shantae, and have I missed anyone? I don't think so. If I have, apologies, but I think it was Shantae, Natasha, Alicia and Laureen. So thank you. And as again, thank you, Ellen, for doing such a fantastic job with your hosting and facilitating. So well done. And of course, thanks to the team behind the scenes who helped put this together. But as I said, I think strength is in unity. Strength and power comes from us all having been together. And so everyone, I think, has made some positive contribution to this being a successful evening. So thanks again. Take on board what's been said, live it, show it, show it through our power. Thank you all, and see you again soon. Take care. Bye.